pasta is not from China, ladies and gentlemen. It's not. Stop telling us that pasta is from China. This video will explain to you how the pasta was invented, why it's not from China, and that you are wrong. Stop being rude and offensive. Hi and welcome to Vincenzo's Plate, the place where you get to learn how to cook beautiful homemade Italian recipes. We're very proud of our pasta and we don't like to you to tell us that pasta is not Italian, pasta comes from China. We love Chinese food. Let me tell you, Chinese food is in the top three best cuisines in the world, like Italian, you know? We love each other's foods a lot, but don't say to us that pasta is from China, because you're wrong, you're rude if you say that, and you're actually offending us, okay? So before you say it, think twice, okay? And this is the reason why you never say that ever again. Now, I have picked three great videos on YouTube that explain to you the pasta history, okay? And I'm going to put together the best parts of these videos so they can explain to you better than I do, okay? I don't want this to come from me. But listen, the first video we're watching is from Epicurious and The Secret History of Pasta. It's a short video, it explains everything to you.
Let's get one thing straight. Pasta is old, like super old. Like super, super old. Well, maybe not that old, but really, where did this stuff come from?
Very, very, very old, okay?
The most common origin story claims pasta was brought to Italy from the east by the explorer Marco Polo. I got some bad news. It's not true. Sorry, pal. It is true a dumpling-like pasta existed in China as early as 1700 BCE, but other forms of pasta existed in Italy before Marco Polo.
We have more than 600 different types of pasta in Italy. Just because of the dumpling, like this guy showed, or the spaghetti, like noodles, it doesn't mean the pasta was created in China. Where I'm from, in Abruzzo, we have a type of pasta that it was invented in the year 1000. After Christ, and it's called pasta alla mugnaia, was a mix of semolina and water. Pasta already existed. They didn't have tomato sauce in it, yes, but the pasta was there way before Marco Polo.
Like a baked doughy pasta called lagane, an ancestor to lasagna. So much like a bowl of delicious angel hair, the ancient world is a seemingly endless tangle of competing pasta threads. But if we slurp our way to the bottom, what's the real pasta predecessor? The answer takes us to the 5th century, where merchants from the Arab world brought dried noodles known as etria, packed for long journeys across the Silk Road, bringing pasta to Sicily centuries before Marco Polo. But once pasta was here, what did Italians bring to the table? What was their special sauce?
Sicily's got a beautiful, beautiful weather, Mediterranean, the semolina is great there, and the Arabs started it, okay? Then what happened with the pasta over the years? Started from Sicily, but it went all the way to the north. Sicily was poor, the north was richer. So when the pasta was created, it was just semolina and water, okay? Because Sicily was poor, and these were poor people ingredients. But when the pasta started to travel through Italy and went to the north part where it was always richer, even now it's richer, they added eggs. They use different flour because they have a different flour in the north. And that's how the fresh egg pasta was created, okay?
Up until this point, pasta was eaten plain or even as a paste. Italy also invented mass pasta production, including the creation of the first pasta machines.
Pasta machine was not created in China.
There's one little detail left. At the time, even the wealthiest, most aristocratic members of society ate pasta like this. Yeah, with their bare hands. And with tomato sauce on the horizon, you can just imagine. But thankfully, there was a hero waiting in the shadows. Forks had never been big in Italy.
This is amazing. This is the beautiful creation, even better than pasta. The fork. What a beautiful, beautiful utensil. The fork. What can you do without a fork? How important is the fork to you?
The match made in heaven. So if you love chowing down on spaghetti, it might be better to thank your fork rather than Marco Polo. It took an awfully long time.
Well said. Say thanks to the fork when you have pasta and forget about Marco Polo. Come on, leave Marco Polo alone. Let's watch the next video. The next video is from a channel called Metatron. It's an English, an English-Italian guy who likes to talk about history, okay?
Pasta, such a popular food throughout the entire planet. Pasta can be enjoyed with a whole variety of recipes, most of which were invented here in Italy, together with an awful lot of shapes and types of pasta that were also invented here. So, recipes are Italian, sauces are Italian, pasta shapes and types are Italian, but was pasta actually invented in Italy? And if the answer is no, then who brought pasta to Italy where it became such a staple food of Italian cuisine?
This guy is very passionate, I can feel it. Very passionate Italian who wants to tell you the history of pasta. I love it. Look how beautiful, look how different these pastas are. Different colors.
Now, before answering this question, I'd like to bring up another one, which is, when did pasta become such a popular food in Italy? Should we imagine medieval Italian knights enjoying pasta for lunch, or should we even...
That's so good. What a question, yeah.
Imagine the ancient Romans having pasta as a meal.
An emperor, like a Roman emperor, should be able to eat a nice plate of pappardelle with wild boar ragu. Oh yes.
Now I am sure you've all heard of Marco Polo and his journeys to China. And you must have also heard about the legend of Marco Polo coming back from China, bringing the Chinese noodles into Italy. And thus the origins of pasta and the introduction of pasta to Italy would be from China. Now, this is a myth, so let's debunk it and I'd like to show you why it is absolutely impossible for that to be the case.
First of all,
impossible! Listen to this guy, please.
When did Marco Polo go to China? Well, Marco Polo went to China during the Yuan Chao or the Yuan Dynasty, so we're talking about 1271. He writes about the Chinese noodles, and that's true, but what he says is that they looked very much like the Italian lagana. Now, what is the Italian lagana? The Italian lagana, singular laganum, was a dish that was popular since the times of Rome, and we will get to that in a minute, but it's a dish that is rather similar to pasta, so this already proves that he knew about that, and he does compare the two and considers them to be similar. But more importantly, to debunk this myth, we have to consider what happened in 1279. In 1279, we have a Genoese soldier, and please keep in mind that Genoa had one of the most important medieval seaports, and we have this soldier who was listing the contents of an inventory of his estates, and within the things in 1279, he lists a basket of dried pasta. Now, it's true that Marco Polo writes his writings in 1271, but he will not come back to Italy from China until 1295, making it 100% sure that pasta was already in use in Italy before his journeys to China.
God, this guy knows his history. I love it. I love it. Listen to these guys. Listen and stop telling us that Marco Polo brought spaghetti to Italy. I can accept spaghetti, even though it's not true, but pasta. Come on, don't say that, guys. I don't like that.
They used to be boiled in order to be cooked, so very similar to the modern sort of pasta that we have in mind when we say this word. And it's from 1154, from Sicily, of course, Norman Sicily at the time. So again, another proof that pasta was popular before the contact with the Chinese in medieval Italy. So you can imagine your medieval Italian knight with his shiny asymmetrical pauldron armor enjoying a nice dish of pasta. The Romans in the first century described lagana as being produced with fine sheets of wheat flour mixed with the juice of lettuce or crushed lettuce juice.
Wow, very interesting. Very, very interesting.
Now, the difference, though, has to do with the way it was cooked. It was not boiled, but it was deep-fried.
Wow, wow, wow. I didn't know that.
In the 5th century, we begin to see or to have mentions of meat-stuffed lagana. a lot closer to modern Italian.
How amazing, eh? How amazing.
Did the Arabs introduce pasta to Italy? Should we consider Lagana as being Roman and therefore pasta actually originated here? Well, it's difficult to say. There is an Etruscan sort of dish which was made of wheat flour to get mixed with water and boiled that sounds a lot like modern pasta. So we could say that perhaps it was an Etruscan thing and then spread or widespread through that. But another possibility is that the Greeks introduced pasta. We have to consider that the Greeks founded Naples and they brought what they called itrion, which was again wheat and flour.
So, wow, I find this fascinating. I'm not an historian, I don't know much about history, but this is really fascinating. I like to listen to this guy, Metatron. I have to subscribe to his channel.
The Arabs, the Etruscans, the Romans, the Greeks, difficult to say. Personally, I think that it might be Etruscan origin and perhaps then changed and evolved with the aid of the Arabs, who were the ones who actually dried it for shipments and transportations.
Amazing. See, you got the answer there. You guys have the answer. There is no Chinese. Pasta is not Chinese. There's one more video I want to watch. It's from Mental Floss. This guy is awesome. He's very passionate as well.
A type of pasta from Calabria in southern Italy. It's a bit like linguine with a few notable differences. It's slightly darker, has a rougher texture, and for much of its history, it was illegal. So how did it go from contraband comestible to a regular in some of the world's finest restaurants? Hi, I'm Justin Dodd. Welcome to Food History.
This guy's great. So in this video, this guy is talking about 14 different pasta shapes, okay? So it's really fascinating. You know, there's a history behind every single pasta shape.
Most people know the story of Italian explorer Marco Polo bringing noodles back from China. It's a fun story, but it's also pretty inaccurate.
Oh, thank you. And these guys, they know what they're talking about. Three people are telling you. Come on, guys.
Pasta was already popular in Italy by the time Marco Polo made his famous voyage to China at the end of the 13th century. And while the Chinese may have been enjoying noodles for thousands of years before pasta first landed in Italy, that doesn't necessarily mean the dish took a direct route from one country to the other.
No, of course not. And like we said, we have 600 different types of pasta in Italy. There's so many.
Credit pasta's arrival in Italy to the Arabs. When Arab groups brought pasta to Italy, it's likely they also shared their technique for drying it, which they developed as a preservation method on long journeys.
And thank you to the Arabs. Thank you. So shukran to all the Arabs who brought the pasta to Italy. Thank you, guys. Thank you. So we share this together with you, okay? We share the pasta love. And I guess, you know, we have 50-50. We say 50% thanks to you guys, 50% thanks to us to take it to the next level.
Pasta found its way to Greece as well. The ancient Greek word for ribbon is itrion, and some experts think this is related to the Arabic word for noodle, itria. Lasagna, one of the earliest known pasta shapes, traces its origins to ancient...
Right, we have to say thanks to Greece as well, so we have to share, guys. 30% each, okay, and we share... we get the credit, okay? But it stays in the Mediterranean countries. That's where the pasta was originated, you know? Greece, Italy, with Arabs' influence.
Today, lasagna is the wide, flat noodle used to make... lasagna, the cheesy, tomatoey dish that's popular with many foodies and 100% of cats who hate Mondays. In a pre-Garfield world, lasagna, called laganon in ancient Greece and laganum in Rome, looked pretty different. As I covered in our episode on ketchup and mustard, the tomato didn't come to Europe until the 16th century, and some interesting ingredients were used in proto-lasagna before its arrival. One early recipe from the late 4th or early 5th century cookbook Apicius called for a sauce of cooked sow's belly, raisin wine, and the breasts of fig peckers to be layered between thin pancakes.
Wow, I'm fascinated. Don't know if I can eat that.
The 14th century Italian cookbook Liber de Cocina looks a little more familiar, with instructions saying to layer grated cheese and spices in with pasta. No mention of fig pecker breasts. How odd.
I like this guy.
Whatever the provenance, Italians embrace pasta, and not just because it tastes good. The region's climate makes it the perfect environment for growing.
I can't believe they ate pasta with the hands. I can't do that, but I can't believe they did.
Durum wheat, the primary ingredient in pasta, along with eggs or water. Dough made with durum wheat flour, or semolina, has a high gluten content that allows it to be stretched into different shapes.
Look at these beautiful shapes. Look how many shapes we have. Look how beautiful they are. So many shapes. And you have semolina and water pasta. which is basically your dry pasta that you buy from the shops, or you have the fresh pasta made by artisans, usually handmade, or, you know, made with the pasta machine, and you have flour and eggs. Sometimes in commercial business, you put semolina as well, so it lasts a little bit longer. That's it, you know, there are two different types of pastas, you know? About 600 different types of pasta shapes.
Durum wheat also sets Italian pasta apart from Asian noodles. Noodles from Asia are traditionally made with rice flour, and even wheat noodles like those found in some Chinese dishes use a different variety of wheat than durum. So, if pasta's from Europe and noodles are from Asia, what does that make vermicelli? Well, depending on the recipe being used, you could fairly put it into either camp. But it first emerged as a pasta in Italy roughly 6 centuries ago.
See? And it's called vermicelli. It's an Italian word, vermicelli. So come on, guys. Come on, stop saying pastas from China.
Mentions of vermicelli comes from The Art of Cooking Sicilian Macaroni and Vermicelli, a recipe book compiled by 15th century culinary giant Martino da Como. Martino cooked for the Duke of Milan and Cardinal Ludovico Trevisan, who was a close advisor to the Pope. Trevisan's opulent banquets helped raise Martino's profile. He's regarded as one of the first celebrity chefs in Western culture. In addition,
can you believe it? Can you imagine YouTube was around at that time? This guy will be huge right now. Can you believe it?
He gave us incredible recipe titles like How to Determine Whether a Cow's Udder is Good and How to Dress a Peacock with All Its Feathers so that when cooked, it appears to be alive and spews fire from its beak. I wish I had made those up, but all the credit goes to Martino. Incidentally, you want to look for a reddish color in your not-too-fatty udder, and the trick to posthumous peacock fire is raw cotton doused in alcohol. Vermicelli is a long, thin pasta, and its name literally translates to little worms. Instead of rethinking this poor branding choice, Westerners decided to apply the name to any Asian noodle that looked similar. The thin noodles are used in dishes like pho and bun bo hu, but don't expect to see the word vermicelli on menus in Asia. It isn't used in these dishes' countries of origin. A variety of regional names for long, skinny noodles are used instead.
Wow, didn't know that. I wish now I know how to call it the real Vietnamese way.
It mentioned in the title of Martino da Como's cookbook is macaroni.
Even macaroni, guys, is Italian. So when you eat mac and cheese, remember the history of macaroni pasta. Don't forget, does it the macaroni pasta deserve that mac and cheese with the milk? No, it deserves a better sauce, guys. Come on, you can do it better. Don't use better ingredients for your mac and cheese. Come on, guys, it was fun to show you this. This is the real story of Italian pasta, which is not from China. Stop saying that to us and be nicer, be more open-minded. Italians have done so much in the world. Great fashion, beautiful cars, beautiful food, beautiful architecture. Fantastic landscapes, fantastic ingredients like extra virgin olive oil, Parmigiano Reggiano, pasta in this case. We have beautiful tourist attractions. We are a beautiful, beautiful culture, beautiful nation. We'll be beautiful people. Italians are very nice and warm, okay? And we also have the mafia, so don't piss us off. Don't piss us off because we always have the connection. But guys, respect us a little bit more, okay? We tell you what we're passionate about, so don't offend us, okay? Because we never forget, and we like to take revenge. So be careful what you say. Thank you guys for watching this episode. I hope it helps, and it's time for you to open your mind and listen to us a little bit more. We'll see you in the next reaction video, every Wednesday here on Vincenzo's Plate. Please subscribe right now.